So guys, what's this all gonna look like when you're done?
What you do is you pan over to this man right here. He talks.
I have the vaguest idea. It's whatever he wants.
The Indiana Jones story started before I was working on the screenplay for Star Wars. When I was thinking about doing a sort of modern fairy tale couched in sort of Saturday matinee serial vernacular, I was thinking about all the great things I can do. And obviously one of the subjects that came up was to do it in outer space and do it sort of like Flash Gordon. And the other idea I had at the same time was really to do it about an archaeologist who goes around finding ancient artifacts that have sort of a supernatural flavor to them. And both of them would be kind of a serial, nonstop action kind of adventure. I decided to really go with the space idea, and I put the archaeologist on the shelf to gather dust. Then I connected with Phil Kaufman, who's another filmmaker up here in San Francisco, and he got very excited about it. And we started working on it for about 3 or 4 weeks. And he had the idea of making the sort of supernatural sacred object that we were looking for, the Ark of the Covenant, because he'd done some research in that. And we went over that, and I said, oh, that's fantastic. It's perfect. It's just what we're looking for. And then Phil went off to work on a Clint Eastwood movie and said, oh, I can't do that movie now. So I put it back on the shelf and let it gather some more dust. And then I shot Star Wars.
George and I had planned this vacation together. He was going to get away from Star Wars opening, which has become a tradition with both of us over the years. And I joined him in Hawaii, and we were just waiting for the grosses to come in, kind of like, you know, waiting for election returns. And it turned out to be a landslide for George Lucas. And George, at that point, just, I think, gushed a sigh of relief. And then change the subject from Star Wars to what I was doing next. And I said, well, you know what? I've always wanted to direct a James Bond picture. And George, so I got that beat. I said, what do you mean? He said, I have a better idea. It's called Raiders of the Lost Ark.
And so I sat down and kind of told him the story about this archaeologist and how it was like a Saturday matinee serial, and he got in one mess after another. And he just said, fantastic, let's do this. Indiana was my dog. Indiana was the prototype for the Wookiee for Chewbacca. He was this big, huge Malamute, would sit next to me in the car, giant bear of a dog. And I named the character after my dog, and ultimately we put that in the movie. Originally when I wrote this, it was Indiana Smith, and then when I told the story to Steven on the beach, he said, I love it, it's fantastic, let's go with it. He said, there's only one thing I don't like. I said, what's that? He said, I don't like the name. And I said, well, all right. Well, what if we call him Indiana Jones? He said, okay, that's fine.
I brought Larry into the picture because I had just bought a screenplay of his called Continental Divide.
He said, I'm going to do an adventure movie with George Lucas. And I showed him the script for Continental Divide, and we think you would be the guy to write this adventure film.
And we spent 3 days with a tape recorder going. And in those 3 days, Larry, George, and I pretty much outlined and sketched in the whole plot, the set pieces, and we laid the movie out in 3 days, and Larry had to go off and put it on paper.
George had things he wanted in the movie, and Steven had kinds of scenes he wanted to shoot, and we were creating a story that would support all these ideas. And in fact, the story we came up with was pretty much like the finished film, but with a few things that we eventually took out.
Larry added so much wit and humor, and Larry brought in such a 1930s Preston Sturges meets Michael Curtiz. Indiana Jones was a little more like Humphrey Bogart from the Treasure of the Sierra Madre, and Larry layered it and flavored it and brought it to life.
And then when I finished the script, and as I had written it all in this, there were no computers then. I was never much of a typist. It's only since computers that I'm able to type, because you can correct so easily, but I never was much of a real typist, so I always wrote things longhand for years, and this is the original longhand script of Raiders.
I had to get the film financed, small detail, and the film did get turned down by everybody in town. Nobody would do it, because everybody looked at this really gargantuan movie with lots of action and lots of stuff, And I was saying, you know, I think we can do this for $20 million. And everybody's saying, we don't believe you. We just, that's impossible. But I had talked to Steven about the fact that we really need to do this like a TV show. We really need to do this like the actual serials were shot, you know, really quick and dirty, use old-fashioned tricks, and, you know, not spend a lot of time on it. And he said, great, that's the way I want to make it. And finally, we got Paramount to say they would do the film. Then we had to figure out who to cast in the part. And Steve said, here's a suggestion. What about Harrison Ford? And I said, oh, Steve, and I said, you know, he's been in two of my movies. I don't want him to be my Bobby De Niro. I don't want to have every movie I make star Harrison.
George and I had tested a lot of potential Indiana Joneses, from Tim Matheson to Peter Coyote to Tom Selleck.
Hello, Mary.
We ended up doing a screen test with Tom Selleck and Sean Young, and it was really, really good. I mean, they were both terrific actors, and it turned out really well.
Look, I did what I did. I don't expect you to be happy about it, but maybe it can do us both some good.
Why start
Just
now?
Just shut up. Shut up and listen to me. Now, I need that piece your father had.
So George and I pretty much went after Tom Selleck, and then a man who became a very close friend of mine, Bob Daley, at that time the head of CBS, said, wait a minute, we have a series commitment with Tom Selleck called Magnum P.I., and he greenlit the series. Tom had a TV series that took him to great, you know, heights of fame and fortune, and we had nothing.
And I said, well, what are we going to do now? And Steve said, well, what about Harrison?
George called me up and told me that he wanted me to meet Steven Spielberg, who I'd not met before, and sent over a script. I read the script, about which I was very enthusiastic, and went over to Steven's house to meet him. And we had a wonderful discussion, got along very well, and I was reluctant to sign up for three films. But knowing the people involved, I was willing to sign up for three in the case of Indiana Jones.
Hello.
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 How are you?
I'm fine, how are you? I'm fine.
Yeah, sure.
Thank you. Whee!
This is the first picture I had ever directed in the UK. And I assumed we would go to the most famous studio there, Pinewood. But George has a good luck theory about all of the Star Wars films having been shot at L Street in England. So I went ahead and looked at the stages, and they were pretty big.
Now, where are we going to have the obelisk? Remember we talked about on the relief?
Yeah, the seven or eight feet.
Yes.
Yeah, enough to identify.
Just 7 or 8 feet is all we need.
And Norman Reynolds was there with me, and he had done Star Wars. And I was very excited to work with the guy that did Star Wars. And yet Norman wanted to do something different than Star Wars. He wanted this to be a whole genre apart from anything that looked futuristic or anything that reeked of technology. And so all of the models and all of the sketches that he had designed absolutely were much more about illustrated graphic novels from the 1930s.
The more information you can impart to the director in terms of models or things in the round, the better, I think. In order to try and help the logistics of working a set and the number of extras, we actually built a sort of mock-up set scale of the location, and we actually put these little figures, like 2,000 little figures, dotted all over the models.
And so we laid it out on a huge model, and I used to like to get my little 35-millimeter viewfinder and lie belly down on that model, trying to find all my angles and get all my shots.
Your legs are in a good position for the kick, so now he's coming, you duck and kick at the same time.
Boom! I had a bit of work to do with the whip, and so I got a fellow to come by my house and coach me in whip craft, which is harder than it seems. And then did a bit of conditioning because I knew it was going to be a physical movie.
The outfit for Indiana Jones, basically the leather jacket, the fedora, and the bullwhip all came from the concept painting that I think was based on some old serials from the late 1930s. And so Indiana Jones's costume came complete before anybody was hired. But Deborah really refined the costume, made it less painterly and more lived in and more honest to who Harrison Ford was and how he could wear those clothes. So she pretty much sort of redesigned the outfit so Harrison would indelibly be only Indiana Jones for the rest of his career.
A costume has to perfectly marry the character so that the audience buys the whole thing. The audience had to buy Harrison even in this exaggerated heroic part, as an earthy, brilliant archaeologist. It had to look like a costume that he slept in and had worn every day of his life. But the truth was, it was a new jacket. And not only was it a new jacket, but there were 10 of them. And there had to be 10 jackets because of the stuntmen, because of the doubles, because of the second unit. The night before we shot our first scene, I sat by the pool with Harrison Ford, and Harrison Ford lent me his Swiss Army knife. And with his Swiss Army knife and a steel brush, I personally aged that jacket, and I had metal splinters in my hands for weeks and weeks and weeks. Then, in terms of his hat, I had to have a hat that was unique, but looked like every hat. I had to have a hat that, if you saw it in silhouette, would instantly be recognizable. There's a very famous men's hatter in Britain on Savile Row, Herbert Johnson. I saw a hat with a very wide brim, and the crown was a little bit too high. It was their Australian model. And with a couple of fittings, we got the hat right for Harrison. Got it really dirty. I took the hat and I rolled it up in my hands. Sat on it, had Harrison sit on it, and when we got through with it, it looked like a nice, old, very well-loved hat.
I just thought it would be fun to start with the Paramount Mountain. I mean, when I was a kid, my first company was called Playmount Productions, and I had a mountain, which I painted myself. Now, Play Mountain is my name in English from German. Spielberg means Play Mountain.
Cover the mountain with smoke, Stephen.
So not quite. Come talk it.
You don't want any in.
No smoke.
Stephen was always coming up with great ideas, which were sometimes a challenge for the production.
Can I have some money for Harrison stepping in?
And we were setting up in Kauai, and he called me over and he said, look, I need to find a mountain. I need you to go find a mountain that looks like the Paramount logo where we can shoot. And I went, okay.
Harrison?
And because it was sort of a last minute request and we didn't have CGI to fall back on, I had to drive around the whole island until I found a location that would work for us, and for a few extra pineapples, we got it.
Cut.
I had never worked with Dougie before, but I had loved his work on other movies. And I thought Dougie could do anything because I looked at all of his films and he changed his style according to what the script was suggesting to him.
I think if you soft light it, we'll see more detail, won't we?
Yes, we will.
I mean, these are scary without having to light them scary.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But actually, this is exactly what one needs.
Just a real soft film.
He had a number of ideas about it. He felt, whatever happens, that we would do it on really widescreen, knowing that we were going to have some fairly large canvases. So that format seemed to be right for them. And he wanted the thing to be very strong looking, but at the same time was happy for me to put in all the shadows I wanted. He wanted both things to look realistic enough to make the make-believe possible.
But the thing I kept saying to Dougie was, I said, you know, let's just, you know, make this look like an old-fashioned kind of an adventure movie. So that was pretty much the concept.
The mosquitoes are near. Poison is still fresh, 3 days. They're following us.
At the time when I got cast in Raiders, I'd done about 4 or 5 years in the theatre. And then I met with Stephen and we chatted for about maybe 10 minutes. And I didn't know what to say because I'd had no film experience. I'd never stepped in front of a camera before. So I had no idea what he wanted. The tarantula thing, that was the first day. And that was my first shot of the first day. And this man arrived with a big suitcase, and inside were all these different compartments with what looked like a tuft of straw in each compartment. And underneath each tuft of straw was a tarantula. So anyway, this guy's kind of putting these spiders on me, and these spiders are more scared than I am. And he's kind of keeping up this running commentary about how the spiders, of course, you know, it's very hard to train tarantulas, you know. He's telling me this whole thing about tarantulas. So they put, I don't know how many, at least a couple of dozen. And they're all on me, and they're not moving. And I hear Stephen say something like, why aren't they moving? They look fake.
And the guy, the spider wrangler, says, "Oh well, because they're all males. You see, we have to put a female in there, then they'll fight." Okay, put a female in there, and he gets a female, and he puts the female spider somewhere on my chair. I can't remember where. Somewhere like here, somewhere. And suddenly, it's like all hell breaks loose. These spiders, they're running and they're dropping and they're kind of fighting and they're running over my face and up. And Stephen's going, shoot, 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 like this. And he's going, "Alfred, Alfred, look scared, look scared." I'm going, "I'm scared, I'm scared."
The idol in the opening sequence that Indy lifts off the altar, that was very much based on an Inca fertility figure. But I did modify it so that it worked better to be held. The size was obviously important. And Stephen went through what he wanted to achieve, like Harrison lifting it off and replacing it with the sand or whatever it was.
The ball was my idea, where we were knocking out set pieces and making suggestions. I just said, you know, at some point some huge boulder should start chasing Indy and almost squishes him 3 or 4 times until he gets out of the cave. And that was just something I thought up. But I didn't know it was going to look as good as that until the day Norman Rendell showed me that he actually made a boulder that was something like 22 feet in diameter. It was extraordinarily large.
The overriding consideration was to be able to stop the thing. You know, if Harrison had tripped up or someone had fallen over and the ball was actually coming through, whilst it was a fiberglass ball, in fact, it was still very heavy and could actually do a lot of damage. And when Stephen first saw it, he was really very excited about the whole thing and immediately said, "Well, why don't we make it, you know, another 50 feet longer," which of course we did.
Indy's character was always a hero that was in over his head. So he was always getting himself hurt and in trouble, and, you know, he wasn't quite up to what he was supposed to be, you know, what the old classic Republic serial hero was. And I think that's one of the things that came off the best.
Dr. Jones, again, we see there is nothing you can possess which I cannot take away.
I was sort of failing in my search for the right cast member, and then I saw this British actor and liked him very much, and I met him. He had amazing eyes, just striking eyes. Could see right through Indiana Jones, and I thought, well, I could have an eye contest here.
You chose the wrong friends. This time it will cost you.
They just said, "Here's the script, go away and read it." And I sat in the front office and read the script. Plainly a wonderful role. And I'd always in my career, I've done a lot of accents. I've done a lot of different voices, so I wasn't bothered about that. But the funny thing was that Stephen didn't ask me if I could do a French accent. I think he just sort of assumed it. And then I went on holiday after. I rang my agent in London. He said, "Stephen suddenly got worried about the French accent. Will you come back to London," because he was by now in Elstree, "and prove that you can do a French accent for him?" So I got rather nervous at that point, thinking, oh my God, now having got the part, then I was going to be tested for it. So I went to Elstree and went into Stephen's office. There was no problem at all. He said, "Can you do a French accent?" I went, "Oh, of course I can do it, in fact," and spoke a little French to him. He said, "Fine," and I walked out, and that was it.
How did you do the tennis line when you first realized it was tennis?
I looked at him halfway into it.
Yeah.
And then when they were finished, I hit the book and I said, "The Nazis have discovered."
It'd be really nice right here, Denham, if you could show that this is a discovery that is rather omnipotent, maybe just some sort of a smile to him, something that you share a private
idea of the greatness of the importance of this find?
Yes.
Okay.
Because yeah. Either of us could answer this question.
Yeah.
Both archaeologists.
I'll
turn into the study of Tavis as one of the possible resting places.
Well, I'd always been a big Denham Elliott fan, and he lent a kind of paternal warmth, a sort of benevolent consigliere to Indiana Jones, who's always saying, I don't want you to get hurt. He's the voice of reason. He's the voice of caution. He's more paranoid than Indy could ever be.
Gotta locate Abner. Think I know where to start. So she'll still be with him?
Possibly, but Marion's the least of your worries right now, believe me, Indy.
It's part of the fun of writing something like this, is getting names that really evoke that kind of movie and that era. And my wife's grandmother was named Marion. I wanted to honor her. She was a woman who I liked very much when I married my wife. And I remember I was driving over Beverly Glen, and when you come on the city side, there's a little side street called Ravenwood. And I thought, oh my God, that's perfect. So I put my wife's grandmother's name with this street name, and that was Marion Ravenwood.
Then it comes down, and Marion takes that drink, right? And you should start glaze over. You should start to be glazing over even as the drink is coming up, right? I always liked Karen, ever since I first saw Animal House, and so she was always sort of floating around in a sea of many possible Indiana Jones leading ladies. I used to have all my interviews in the kitchen over at Lucas's place called the Egg Company, so we would cook, and that everybody relaxed. Once you're making bread with your potential director and your casting director and about five other people. So that was my technique of trying to get actors to relax in these meetings, and it worked great. It's really swell. Perfect introduction for your character.
I met Stephen. We just met, had a conversation, and then he flew me to Los Angeles several weeks later, and I did a screen test with Tim Matheson first. So we did the bar scene.
I've learned to hate you in these last 10 years, but no matter how much I hated you, I always knew someday you'd come through this door. I never doubted it. Something made it inevitable. So why are you here? Now, tonight.
And they asked me to stay in Los Angeles for a couple of days, and they brought John Shea in, and I did a second screen test with John Shea.
Karen was the clear favorite because she had spunk and she was sort of a firebrand, and she reminded me of the 30s women. She had that kind of Irene Dunne quality about her, and a little bit of the Carol Lombard, and she just seemed perfect for the part.
Indiana Jones. Always knew someday you'd come walking back through my door. I never doubted that. Something made it inevitable. So what are you doing here in Nepal?
I need one of the pieces your father collected.
If I was going to swing a punch, I wanted to swing a punch. And I wasn't going to, you know, kind of do it halfway.
Do that line again.
I need one of the pieces your father collected.
Like that. On the way back, the punch is in delivery, uncollected.
Okay, then I'll get collected out here. I need one of the pieces your father collected.
So I think I clipped Harrison on the chin a time or two, maybe. Although I never, on purpose.
Good evening, Fräulein.
Ron Lacey had a huge history of playing different character parts all over England, but when I first met him, he reminded me of Peter Lorre.
Bar's closed.
We are... Not thirsty.
Ronnie was one of the nicest of men. He'd been a good working actor for most of his life and had just not got anywhere. He'd actually decided to give up acting and he became an agent. And I think it was in about 3 or 4 months of, you know, trying to represent his fellow actors when he got cast in Raiders of the Lost Ark, which of course got him started again as an actor.
No, candle! Ronnie! It was kind of scary because Kit West had to set fires close to the crew, but also he had, you know, the big machine that turns the fires off, and all the wood was treated so it couldn't really catch and spread.
But, you know, it got really hot on that set. We had everything on fire, the curtains, the window frames, the ceiling was on fire at one point, the entire bar burns up.
Right from the time that the set was designed, we had to have certain sections which we knew that we would be able to add special pipes in and concrete floor, because that studio had had a big blaze on one of the previous pictures, and they were naturally, knowing our intentions of having a fairly hefty fire in there, they were very, very anxious. And so we had to go right from scratch and make sure that the materials were pre-soaked in special fire retarding solution.
Going together? Kid is safety first. That's why I usually hire a physical effects supervisor who really puts safety before anything else.
Will Jones, least you haven't forgotten how to show a lady a good time.
The first question I asked, actually, before I even read the script, when it said it's in Egypt, I said, do we see the Sphinx, the pyramids, or any of that? I said, no, just the streets. I said, then we don't have to go to Egypt. Tunisia is a much easier place to shoot, and we'd been there before, so I knew the country. We found the site for the Tanis digs. This was right in the area where we shot Star Wars. The canyon where Indy is above them and they've got the arc going down is the same canyon where R2-D2 is taken by the Jawas in Star Wars. It's exactly the same location. And then we went to shoot Cairo. We went to a town called Kerouan, which actually means Little Cairo, so it was quite apt, and that's where we shot all the stuff in the streets.
If I could just do the whole whip fight and the sword fight and everything in here. The orange gag, the butcher's thing, and then the basket comes through here.
Another challenge that we had was, of course, shooting the period for the 1930s. And once we got to these locations, once again, we didn't have computers that could erase wires and TV antennas and everything. We had to do it ourselves.
This is another good angle right over here. This
we probably removed 200 or 300 aerials, especially from the wide panoramic shot that brings Sala and Marion and Indy out onto the veranda. But in a way, I kind of like that a lot of effort went into creating an authenticity that couldn't have been phonied up 23 years ago.
Cairo, city of the living. A paradise on earth.
The first person I offered Sala to was Danny DeVito, and he was dying to play this character, but he had problems with his television series not being able to make the dates work and eventually couldn't do it. But he was my first choice to play Sala. And then when I saw Shogun, I said, I don't know who this British actor is. He's like Falstaff, great basso profundo voice and tremendous sense of humor. And I said, that's Sala. We got to get him in the picture.
Well, you see, if they call him, if I make it sound differently.
Yeah, make it sound differently, yeah.
But if I do, then I can't have heard it.
I went and saw Stephen, and I said, well, here's the thing. Sala is described as a 5'2", skinny Egyptian digger. What do you propose, surgery? And he said, no, just, I want to cross between the character you played in Shogun and Falstaff. I thought, oh, that's interesting.
How about just saying, today, you rest, you shop, you let Marion spend all your money.
Those scenes were fun. I enjoyed doing those, all the running around in the marketplace and stuff. Any moment where I could join and be useful and resourceful had meaning for me.
Action time. Real time.
All of that stuff became a part of the character, and I was really happy to have it, as opposed to just being somebody running, you know, like scared. Ah, you know, to have like, you know, a frying pan in my hand that I could then conk the guy in the head with and stuff.
So leave the door open. Right, open now, but hide around the corner, please. Yeah? Okay.
There was so much stress shooting in Tunisia that we just wanted to go home. I mean, you know, I had a 6-week schedule in Tunisia. I did it in about 4.5 weeks because it was super hot, hard to breathe. You couldn't take a deep breath.
We should have guys up here digging.
Plus, we all began getting sick. I didn't get sick because I subsisted on canned food from the UK that I just literally opened my cans and sometimes cold had my breakfast, lunch, and dinner from canned food. But all the rest of the crew who ate at the restaurants or at the hotels, they all got sick.
I have never been so ill on a film set. I think I actually had cholera. I had a temperature of 105 point something. I was dying.
There's a scene that was actually cut from the original film where a young soldier is ordered to shoot me. Stephen said to me, John, can you bend down to give him a better eye line? And as I bent down, I filled my jalaba in front of 200 people, and I didn't care.
Thank you, mon père. Mon grand-père.
I want you to work on the diction now.
Monsieur Alger.
There would be times on the set where I would use the second camera, and I would be on the second camera, and I'd be either shooting things that Steve had told me, or I'd say, hey, here's a great shot, why don't I shoot this? And he'd say, yeah, great, do that. And we sort of were trading off operations, and you know, he let me shoot second camera. I think he was doing it just to be nice to me.
If you're trying to escape on foot, the desert is 3 weeks in every direction. So please eat something.
That's one of my favorite sequences, and it was born out of a problem, and that was there was no reason for my character to put on that dress.
It's beautiful.
I would very much like to see you in it.
Ha! Bet you would.
So Stephen challenged me to find something. You know, it was sort of like, okay, well, you come up with a good reason why she would put on that dress, and you show it to me, and, you know, we'll see. So it was not difficult at all to enlist Paul. And we went into the tent and just did little improvisations together. And out of that improvisation came this thought that what if there was a sharp knife that was there on that plate? And what if, from the moment I put on the dress, you see that I'm using my clothes to hide the fact that I'm going to take the knife? And that we created a little story around that. And we also thought it was kind of beautiful to bring maybe the drinking contest back into the story, and that I think I'm going to drink him under the table to be able to escape. And as we're improvising, I just thought, this is it. You know, we found it. This is just so lovely. You know, it has so many wonderful little twists and turns.
We meet again, Fräulein. Americans, you're all the same. Always overdressing for the wrong occasions.
You remember this coat hanger sequence, the famous thing where Ronnie Lacey looks as though he's producing this instrument of torture. And Ronnie's such a wonderful actor, too. His timing is superb. The audience actually do go, what's he gonna do? And then he turns it into this coat hanger.
You see, the scary thing is once it gets long,
yeah, I know.
That's the threat. But then suddenly get to the end, you can look at it just for a moment, to get the end and put it together and just instant coat hanger.
It's such a brilliant gag. And it turned out that it was a gag that Stephen had been working up, that he'd used it in 1941 before with Christopher Lee, I think, in the submarine playing it. And for some reason or other, it didn't work, and Stephen knew it didn't work, and he was so fond of this gag. It's a nice idea, isn't it, that you keep reworking the gag till you get it right, like Buster Keaton would, you know.
What shall we talk about?
Cut.
The Well of Souls, the big figures, the Anubis figures, were jackals of the dead. One of the first things I've thought of, really, was opening the well and seeing the head of one of these figures, which seemed to me to be, they lent themselves to that, all sort of looking up, you know, ready to sort of gobble you up. But everything in there was really entirely Egyptian, apart from little engravings of 3PO on the wall, one or two other little niceties that Stephen had suggested.
Snakes. Why did it have to be snakes?
I cannot tell you how many times I get asked to do asps. Very dangerous. You go first.
Asps. Very dangerous. You go first.
I grew up in Africa, and part of my childhood fears and phobias are very linked with snakes. I was not wildly happy about snakes.
I'll be right down to talk to you about the mechanical snakes. We've got to work out something else. And if you, I'll be right down.
I found that I was able to clear up a lot of my phobias on these movies. For example, I never really liked snakes, so I had to find a reptile expert in Europe. And I guess once that I learned that the snakes that we were working with were non-poisonous, it was a little easier to just pick them up. So We brought in a bunch of these snakes and we put them in the shot, and I think we had about 1,000 snakes, which I assumed was plenty.
I gotta have live snakes and there's not enough.
The set's too big for the amount of snakes that we have.
We had 2,000-3,000 snakes and they hardly covered. I couldn't get a wide shot. I couldn't go back because I would see that there were no snakes on the sides. So that's when I said to Robert Watts or to Frank Marshall,
we have to get more snakes. You know what we really need? We need about 7,000 snakes in addition to the 2,000 we have here to make it work.
He said, we don't have enough snakes. Can you get them? I said, absolutely, Stephen. And I rushed away because our mantra then was, we can do whatever you want. So we looked all over Europe and we got 3 or 4 other snake breeders to deliver boxes and boxes of glass snakes.
I just remember this image of these gnarly snakes being regurgitated out of trash cans and then untangled, spread out by crew members all over the floor of this set. And I'm not afraid of snakes, but that made me nauseous. That made me want to puke. Just seeing the Medusa tangles being, you know, just spread around. And some of them were pythons, which they're not poisonous, but man, when they bite, they don't let go. And at one point, David Tomlin got bit by a python. And David just stood there with the python not letting go, and some blood was coming down David's hand. David just stared at it and said, hey, somebody grab the tail and give it a snap. It'll make the head let go. I don't know how David knew this. Somebody grabbed the tail of that python, went like this. The shock wave went up to the head, and the head let go. The snake was fine. David got some medical attention, then he was fine.
Okay, watch your hand. He's about to bite you right there. He's about to bite. What is his name? He's good for a close-up. He's good for a close-up.
He's good for jewels.
One more right here. He's got coil. No, I want the biters out right now. Two biters. Him and him.
There were a lot of snakes. Actually, I wasn't there when they shot the snakes. And that's one of the reasons why Steven directed the movie and I didn't direct the movie, because I didn't want to sit on a soundstage with 1,000 snakes for a week trying to get that sequence shot. You know, I'm just too lazy a guy for that.
I want one person whose job it is only to keep the pythons away from endangering the actors.
Let's reconsider this whole thing.
I personally don't have any fear of snakes, or for that matter, bugs or rats, happily. The snake sequence had a lot of people very apprehensive, but it didn't bother me at all, really.
Just get ready to shoot right away.
But the day that the cobras arrived, everything changed. Everybody was very serious about the cobras being there. We had anti-venom serum. We had a lot of protection for the handlers, and even the actors were very respectful of these snakes because they were deadly.
In the famous shot of me facing the cobra, you can barely see a reflection on the sheet of glass that was between myself and the cobra. They took some elaborate precautions on that occasion.
I told you it would be all right!
And at one point, it hooded and whipped its head off to the side and literally threw venom all over the glass. So that was something that caused everybody to sit up and take notice and recognize that this was not something to play around with.
I do remember the snakes were supposed to recoil from fire, but in fact they got close to fire to get warmed up.
You don't like fire? You do like fire. You love fire. In the script, you're supposed to hate fire. Why do you like fire? You're ruining my movie.
Harrison's in these big boots and he's got these long hefty pants on and he's got the whip and he's hat. I'm in this little white dress with nothing on my arms and nothing on my legs. And, of course, I have to lose a shoe. And I'm surrounded by the snakes. And it's just, you know, there was a part of me that I, you know, I just thought, you know, I want the big, heavy boots. I want the big, heavy shoes. And I didn't want to feel as exposed as I felt in those clothes often, you know. Which, of course, is part of the fun of the whole thing.
Frozen a second, and then a shriek, and back to Harrison's back. Let's see that. Right, that's just getting up. Good, that's funny. That's the idea.
Karen was really fun to work with because, you know, when I first met Karen, I knew that she was a serious actress, but she's never gone to the school of Indiana Jones. So she took a crash course on a different kind of acting. But once she got into it, She was absolutely terrific. Herself came up with even worse things for me to do to her.
Maybe by that time I could just start batting him.
Oh, yeah, I know what we should do. When we get to the next skeleton, that's a good idea. That's a great idea. Wait a second. That's terrific. So great, my earphone broke in half. That's how good the idea was.
That sequence was much more horrible than the snakes for me because it was physically very demanding. I was alone in the catacombs, and we did a whole sequence of me running through the catacombs and various things happening. But I found that much more difficult than the snakes. I'll take the snakes any day of the week.
And action. No, okay, it's gotta be. But you saw what Karen did was right. What you did was absolutely right. That's the timing of the shot.
But I was so happy when that sequence was completed.
In terms of the flying wing, when I first read the script, I had no idea of what that really meant. So I researched that and discovered that, in fact, the American Air Force had developed a flying wing during World War II that wasn't very successful. But nevertheless, the thing actually existed, and we set about sort of designing the wing for the film.
I remember that was an interesting scene because I began storyboarding it, and I had about 15 storyboards. But then I threw out the storyboards, and I began just to choreograph the fight. And I basically made that scene up as we shot it. One punch at a time, one duck at a time, one almost going into the prop and then backing up. That scene was only meant to be a couple of punches and turned out to be something like 60 or 70 different shots. And that was so much fun to work on because we just were making it up every single moment.
Spend about 6 seconds looking for it and come up with it.
Okay.
And click it when you come back up. Right. Just follow the fight without pointing.
Intelligent
giant.
Okay.
On the morning that we were starting the sequence, all of the stuntmen were sick and they were at the hotel and we didn't have anybody to play the flying wing pilot who had to get hit over the head with the chocks, which was a really tough stunt. So Steven said, well, Frank, put on the outfit. Get in the cockpit. And I thought, oh, this will be fun. Little did I know that it was 3 days in a jumpsuit in a cockpit that was about 140 degrees. Maybe the stuntmen were sick on purpose that day.
At a certain point, I slipped and fell, and the wheels rode up onto my knee, which resulted in me tearing the anterior cruciate ligament in my left leg in the middle of Tunisia. So rather than submit to any local medical care, we just wrapped it up and put ice on it and carried on.
Holy smoke, my friends! I'm so pleased you're not dead! Indy, we have no time. If you still want the Ark, it has been loaded onto a truck for Cairo.
Truck? What truck?
Stand by, this is picture. Ready, sir. Right. Okay, turn it on and roll cameras.
I had never given up in my life. Of course, I hadn't made that many movies yet, but I had never given up that much second unit before. And I gave the entire truck chase over to Mickey Moore, who I trusted completely. And I had all the storyboards, and he pretty much did copy the storyboards. But he would also throw in one or two bonus shots, which really gave flavor, even more energy to that sequence.
Now we start to tighten up here, where we see the truck now starting to catch up again with the lead car. Reaction, I thought this wasn't in it, but we need it to keep them alive.
Gotta have that.
They're in the front.
Did you add these two shots?
Yeah.
Overall, the whole chase was probably 6 to 8 weeks. And then, of course, Steven went back and filled in all the close shots with Harrison. I was able to make one shot for Steven with actually Harrison being dragged.
Dragging behind a car. Dragging behind a car.
I roll cameras!
I'm sure it's not dangerous.
See, if it was dangerous, they would wait until we got more of the movie done.
Put your head up just a little if you can, that's it. Hold it. That's good.
I would want to see Mickey's dailies before I would see my own dailies. Because I would want to see, well, how's the second unit doing with the truck chase? And, then dailies have to go to England and then come back to Tunisia. So it was a couple days before I would see any of the dailies from Mickey's shoot.
And I can't think of through the whole chase where Steven ever phoned and said, Mickey, I don't like so-and-so. Why don't you do it over? That was very encouraging to me and the unit that I had behind me. I had a wonderful unit. I have one belief as a second unit director. The better the help you have around you, the better you're going to be. It was just a matter of being able to get it the way he visioned, and that's what we tried to do.
Terry, go! Terry, go!
The Bantu wind was rusty and really, really beaten up, and it seemed to fit the part, as it were. And as the time approached, I decided to go back and just check it out, and to my horror, I discovered that the whole boat had been repainted. There were no rust marks. It was painted white and blue, I recall. So with very little time left, I had to actually get our paint team over and put it back to the condition that it was in when we actually found it.
What's happening? We have most important friends.
We tried to get a submarine. We didn't want to build a submarine from scratch. And there was a movie that they hadn't made yet called Das Boot, Wolfgang Petersen's television epic that became a 2.5 hour long feature film. And they had built the boat, so we rented the Das Boot boat, put our own numbers on it, and shot that in La Rochelle, France.
Not only was the sub there, but there was a Second World War German submarine pen there, complete, even to the graffiti on the walls that was still there from the Second World War. So it was almost a set in existence.
The final sequence, of course, the problem for an actor with that final sequence, and especially in those days when we weren't used to blue screen, was that you had to be talked through every moment.
Bellick starts to hear a rumble coming from the arc. He starts to hear a sound, and he takes a step back, and the rumble increases, the hum increases, and then a bluish green gaseous veil spills from the arc and starts to crawl down the steps.
Everything was storyboarded. So everybody, the actors included, could walk up and say, oh yeah, that, I'm reacting to that ghost, the pretty ghost that becomes the skeleton that dissolves before the eyes and gets them to start screaming.
And of course, it was my first experience with acting to nothing. You know, I mean, it was Steven over on the sidelines going, and now the head is exploding, and you know, there's something coming out, which I have now since done so many times on so many films.
Don't look, Marion.
And the glow starts to come up. Glow.
As far as I was concerned, as an actor, the sequence had finished with me screaming. I'd had to spend quite a few takes screaming and screaming and screaming, so they just got the wide open mouth ready for that sequence. So it was amazing to see the finished sequence and see what they'd done with my head. I had no idea that's what was going to happen.
Of course, which is typical of making movies, there's nothing really there until the premiere, when the actors first get to see what they were being so foolish about.
Cut. Great, John.
Movie making is a collaboration, and we had some wonderful collaborators on this movie, and that's what makes each sequence so exciting. And putting that all together was a masterpiece of editing by Michael Kahn.
Steven has his famous phrase, he shoots for the editing room, and I had a lot of footage. And it's good to know as an editor that all the pieces you put together mean something by putting in a certain reaction or putting in a shot, a point of view, or overlapping track. There's a lot of devices that are used to influence an audience. Millions of people see it and they respond to it. Sometimes it needs just a little touch. It needs another beat, or it's a beat too much. It's all very sensitive. How you put it together really affects the audience psychologically.
I thought when I first read the script that Indiana Jones was going to be fun to watch, and I had great confidence in Steven as a filmmaker, but you still never know what the mood of the audience is going to be when the film is released. So I was very pleased at the amount of success that we had with it.
Try the hard, and then just like he's made of chiffon, pulling him like that. Try that once.
I was blown away by it when I saw it. I saw a different movie in my head, and I think I came to see that the movie I saw in my head was not the movie we were making. And so I think when we finished the film, I was a little puzzled by what we had done. And when I went into the theater and sat down, I was like, whoa, I got it instantly. I mean, I saw what he was doing, and I saw the film that he was making, and I knew it was really good. I knew it was something people would respond to.
I can't go back and look at a lot of my movies without either punching holes in them or just kind of like flinching and going, ooh, I could have done that better. I have probably a handful of films that I've directed that I could watch objectively as if I didn't have anything to do with the movie. And Raiders is one of those films that I can look at with my kids and divorce myself from all my knowledge and forget how it was made and watch it from the point of view of an audience. And that's what's fun about that picture. That was a gift that Raiders gave back to me, was it let me watch it objectively 20, 25 years later.
It was one of those rare occasions where everything, the script came out better than we expected, the movie came out better than we expected, everything sort of just came together and was brilliant.